Good morning. So glad to see you here on this wonderful Lord's Day. We're excited to come together and worship our great God together. And if you're joining us online, we just want to welcome you and thank you for joining us online. We're thankful for the ability to do that. If you're a guest joining us, we are so excited to have you here with us this morning. We just want to get to know you, how we could pray for you, how we could serve you. We want to connect with you. So out in the foyer, but also over in our Welcome Center, which is over to my left, your right, are some connect cards. So at the end of the service, if you'll just do us a favor, just take a moment to some brief information, fill out that connect card, then you can take it over to the Welcome Center. There'll be someone there at the desk, and they'll be glad to receive that card. And we want to give you a gift to show our appreciation of you being here today. But we are thankful that you're here. We're thankful for everybody that's here today as we've come to worship our great God. We're here to praise our great God today. And as we begin, I want to read the entire Psalms of Psalms 150 and just hear how important praise is to Almighty God. It says, praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him from His mighty for His mighty deeds. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Praise Him with trumpet sound. Praise Him with lute and harp. Praise Him with tambourine and dance. Praise Him with strings and pipe. Praise Him with sounding cymbals. Praise Him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So that's pretty clear. God's word has called us to praise Him. Now I think this includes all of us. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. So that, don't think you're exempt this morning because you're breathing. So if we have breath, we're called to praise God. And just stop and think about who God is. Think about what He's done for you. Think about how He loves you, how He watches over you and cares for you each and every day. What He's done for you this week even. The small stuff to the big stuff. We have great reason to praise God this morning. And that's what we've come together to do. We've come to praise God this morning. So I just want you to keep that in mind as we sing just a moment here, as we pray together, as we study God's Word together. Let's just praise our great God this morning. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful and thankful for who You are. And we give You praise for who You are. You are worthy of our praise just simply for who You are, Almighty God, the Creator of heaven and earth, the Sustainer and the Giver of life. And Father, we are thankful for what You do in our lives each and every day to watch over us and care for us, to meet our needs. And Father, just when we think that things aren't going to turn out and problems be solved and issues be taken care of, You show up and You resolve these things and we give You praise. Just when we think we have needs that won't be met, You show up and You provide for our needs. And we give You praise. We give You praise for Jesus Christ, sending Your Son to die on the cross to pay the penalty for my sins and the sins of all of mankind. We give You praise that through Jesus and Jesus alone that we can have forgiveness of sins and salvation and everlasting life. There's so much that we could praise You for. So as we sing this morning, we may not just mouth words that are on a screen. May we truly sing from the heart this morning. Doesn't matter how we sound. We're called to make a joyful noise. We have much to be joyful for because of who You are. We have much to praise You for. And as we pray together, as we study Your Word together, may we just have this attitude of praise because You are worthy of our praise. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Glad to see everybody. We just heard the preacher speak. And that's the reason we're here, to give praise to the Lord. So here's your chance. We're going to sing this song. We can start off with praise to the Lord. Let us stand.
Great is Your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So remember Your people, remember Your children. Your grace is enough.
Here it comes. You ready? Here's the question. Aren't you thankful God's grace is enough?
Yeah.
All right. Good deal. Y'all sounded better each week, so that's good. So I might do that every week. I ask you a question that you got to respond to, but stop and think about that. We don't need to add anything to what Jesus Christ has done. What he did on the cross of Calvary for us accomplished everything we need for our salvation. His grace is enough. We can't earn our salvation. We can't buy our salvation. Jesus' grace is enough. And that's the God that is worthy of our praise this morning. Well, as we come to our prayer time this morning, I do want to share a few requests, give you some updates on some things, and just ask you to continue praying, because we know prayer works in a mighty way. We've seen prayer work in a mighty way, and I'm going to share another example of that in just a moment here. But first off, I want to ask you to pray for Rodney Laughing House. Rodney was up here leading us in music. Rodney had open heart surgery back in the fall and has recovered from that, but he's still having some issues or trying to figure out what that is. So this Friday, Rodney's going for heart catheterization. So if you would pray for Rodney and Dorinda, pray for the doctors for them to figure out what's going on, what's causing these issues he's having, and just they can move past that and he can be feeling better. And also, we want to pray for our ladies. Next Sunday is Baptist Women's Day, and our ladies are leading us in worship, and we are excited about that, so pray for them as they prepare. They met this Wednesday for choir practice and sounded great. They're going to meet this Wednesday again after Bible study for choir practice, so I want to invite you out for that, ladies. I want to encourage you to pray for Sherry Clayton. She's our guest speaker next week, and she's speaking on behalf of Cry Freedom Missions. And in case you don't know what Cry Freedom Missions is, this is a ministry that seeks to rescue those that are in human trafficking. They pull them out of human trafficking. They send them to a safe house. They help meet physical needs, but they share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. And so many ladies' lives have already been turned around through this great mission. And so I want to encourage you to be here to hear how you can be a part of this great opportunity so you can pray for this great ministry, so you can be involved in it. They need volunteers, but also so you can give if that's what the Lord lays in your heart to do, to help rescue people from human trafficking and ultimately share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. So that's next Sunday. Be praying for Baptist Women's Day next Sunday. And then, of course, we want to continue praying for all those that have been affected by this earthquake and Turkey and Syria. Last I checked, the death toll was over 46,000 people. I mean, that's just mind-boggling to me. But, I'm thankful that God has Christians on the ground, Samaritan's Purses there, as I mentioned. They've set up their field hospital. It's filled with people that are hurting. And Southern Baptist Disaster Relief are there. They're helping people, meeting needs. But ultimately, these Christian organizations are sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ in this predominantly Muslim area of the world. And so this is a great opportunity for God's name to be proclaimed, for the gospel to be proclaimed, and people who have lost everything, people who have lost loved ones, realize their Muslim faith does nothing for them, but Jesus is the one who gives them hope. Jesus is the one who gives them peace. So we'll be praying for a great salvation of souls through this great tragedy over in Turkey and Syria. And of course, we want to continue praying for Pastor Cameron. He is in Moldova right now. He is well into his Sunday. They're 7 hours ahead of us. And God is blessing in a mighty way. If you're here Wednesday night, I shared how God changed the schedule already. His flight was delayed coming out of Turkey, and he had a 12-hour layover. He was up for like 40 hours, but God has been blessing in a mighty way. They've had great meetings. They've had great conferences so far, as God has been using Pastor Cameron to preach the Word of God. And so they have great plans for this summer, as we're going to send a team to Moldova this summer, Lord willing, and we're looking forward to that. And we actually be praying for last night. They had that youth conference. Remember, this was a youth leaders meeting at first, like 20 youth leaders, developed into a conference in one of the major cities, which we've never been able to do stuff in the cities, and they're expecting 300 teenagers. Well, as of, I think it was Friday when Pastor Cameron texted me, he said that had grown. They were expecting over 500 teenagers last night. And so we praise God for that. That's answered to prayer. And so Pastor Cameron said, please tell the church, thank you for praying, because God is moving in an amazing way. And I'm looking forward to hearing what God did last night in that youth conference. And as Pastor Cameron's going to be coming back this week, he's going to be sharing here in the near future about that. So continue praying for what God is doing in Moldova, and pray for Pastor Cameron as he'll be returning home. Pray that he'll get some rest, because he's going to be wore out, exhausted. If you know Pastor Cameron, he's like the Energizer Bunny. He just keeps going. And so God is using him greatly there, though. And then I want to share about an opportunity to bless a dear couple in our church. Some of y'all may know Vic and Delora Roberts. Some of you may not. They've not been able to come in a while because they're shut-ins, but they are getting ready to celebrate their 70th wedding anniversary at the end of the month. And so out in the Welcome Center are some anniversary cards. So we want to encourage you after the service to go out there and just write a quick note of congratulations to them. We're going to get these cards to them so as they celebrate their 70th wedding anniversary, just encourage them. They would love to be here. And they were here for decades serving and just doing God's work and serving you all. But because of health concerns, they haven't been able to be here in a long time. But we just want to be a blessing to them and encourage them. Just tell them thank you for being the example of a godly Christian couple that we can celebrate with them their 70th wedding anniversary. And so we're looking forward to that coming up. And so we just praise God for that. So I want to encourage you to sign those cards out in the Welcome Center as you head to Sunday school this morning. We're also going to pick them up, and Carol's going to pick them up and pass them out to our Sunday school classes. So if you don't get to it then, you'll get to it in Sunday school. And we're going to do the same thing with the 11 o'clock service. So just praise the Lord for that. So I want to encourage you to be a part of that. Well, let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the privilege and joy of just coming to praise you this morning, Lord. And we just are grateful for who you are and just your love for us. And we thank you that your grace is enough. We don't need to add anything to you, what you've already done. You've done enough. You've done more than enough. And through you, Jesus, we have forgiveness of sin. Through you, we have salvation. We have everlasting life. We have this phenomenal relationship with you. Father, we give you praise. And we just want to worship you this morning accordingly. Father, we thank you for answered prayer. We thank you for what you're doing and continuing to do in Moldova. How you took a youth leaders meeting, turned into a youth conference of 300, then turned into a youth conference of over 500 teenagers there last night. And Father, you know the results. You know what took place. And I know you empowered Pastor Cameron to preach the word. But we just pray for those that gave their life to Jesus Christ. We just pray that you grow them to be men and women of God. We thank you for the plans that have already been made for this summer, Father. And the meetings that have gone well, the conferences that have gone well. And we just pray you continue to use Pastor Cameron, even now today, as he's preaching multiple times throughout this Sunday day. And even though they're getting close towards the evening of the day, Father, we just pray you continue to use him, but sustain him. And give him the strength he needs. Give him good rest and keep him safe as he travels home. And just take care of all the logistics of his flights and get him home safely. And let him rest up. And I know he's just going to want to hit the road running, but he needs to rest as well. So we just pray you just strengthen him and rest him, Father. And Father, we just thank you for being with Rodney and Dorinda and all that Rodney's been through in the fall with his open heart surgery. Now there's some issues he's having, and I just pray as he has his heart catheterization on Friday, Father, I just pray that if it is something with the heart, they figure out what it is. If it's not, then lead him to what else is causing these issues that he's having, Father. But I just pray you give the doctors wisdom and guidance. And Lord, just continue to give Dorinda and Rodney and the family a peace about this, that you're going to continue to watch over Rodney and take care of him like you have. And we know you'll continue to do it in the future, but we just pray they can figure out what's going on. Father, we just want to continue to pray for all those affected by this massive earthquake in Turkey and Syria, Lord. And we know that, you know, over 46,000 people have lost their life. But Lord, we know that you're working. You have Christians in a predominantly Muslim area providing help, meeting needs, and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you've opened this door up for Christians to go in and provide hope and peace to people that are hurting and suffering, people who put their faith in a false god. So, Father, I pray through this tragedy, through this devastation in people's lives, they will see Jesus Christ for who he is, the Savior they need in their life, the Son of God who's come to save them from their sins. Lord, we pray for a great harvest of souls through this tragedy as the gospel will be shared. And Father, we just pray for our ladies next Sunday as they lead us in worship to Baptist Women's Day. We're excited to hear what you're doing through Cry Freedom Missions. And Lord, I know I already get to hear because my girls work there. And Father, I just am excited about this great ministry that you're rescuing people from human trafficking. And Lord, not only are they just being rescued, but their lives are being changed for all eternity because they're hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're giving their life to Jesus and they're serving, Father. and you're turning the lives of these ladies around that you've already rescued. And we pray that you just continue to do a great work through Cry Freedom Missions. And Lord, I just pray you should be with Sherry next week as she shares about it. Be with us, that we respond the way you're leading us to respond, to be a part of this great work. And Father, be with our ladies as they lead in worship as well. And Lord, as we continue in worship in this time, I just pray you're honored and glorified. And we ask this in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. All right, if you'll take your Bibles and turn to the book of James. James chapter 1 is where we still are. We are in the midst of a study working our way through the book of James. And as I've said probably every Sunday now, James is such a practical book for the Christian life. I love it because it tells us so much of how we're called to live our life for Christ. And today we're talking about advice to live by as we look at verses 19 through 21 of the book of James, James chapter 1. Have you ever noticed how, you know, a lot of mothers have pieces of advice that are very good and they seem to get passed down through the ages? You know, we remember the advice that our mothers give us, and not that our fathers don't give us advice, but for me, it seems like I remember the things my mom said advice-wise better than the things that my dad said. But it's things we pass down. Some things are great pieces of advice. Some things we might still be trying to figure out if that's a good piece of advice or not. I mean, think about it. Here's something maybe your mom said, maybe something you passed down to your kids or grandkids. Now, this is a famous one. Think before you what? Speak. That's right. I mean, that's a good piece of advice. We should think before words come out of our mouth. That could save us a lot of trouble, but oftentimes we just speak, don't we? What about this one? Look both ways before you cross the road. Another good piece of advice. Now, this one, I'll be honest with you. I'm not sure about this one, why this one might be beneficial, but did your mom ever tell you this? Always put on a clean pair of underwear because you never know when you're going to be in an accident. So, yeah, many of y'all, your mama told you that. I don't get that one because you know what? If you're in an accident and it's bad enough, the EMTs show up, they don't care if you got clean underwear on. The doctor's not going to care if you got clean underwear on. You know, if it's a bad enough accident, it may not be clean anymore. I don't know. So not all advice is good, solid advice to live by. And some things we just don't quite get. Now, I admit my mom has given me advice over the years that I still live by and I still take in. And, you know, it's good advice to live by. But let's just be honest, not all the advice we get in life from whatever the source is necessary good advice to live by. And I looked on the internet about different pieces of advice that people give, and I came across this list. And I'll let you be the judge or not whether it's a good piece of advice to live by or not. But here's some of the things of advice I found out there. Never have more children than you have car windows. I don't quite get that one. I guess every child needs a window to look out of, but here's another one. Now, I think this is a good piece of advice, and I can say this because my kids aren't in here this morning. Never loan your car to someone to whom you have given birth. So now, I know I didn't give birth to them, but they're my kids and everything, but that might be a real good piece of advice. Now, what do you think of this one? Pick your friends carefully. Here's what it says. A friend never goes on a diet when you are fat or tells you how lucky you are to have a husband who remembers Mother's Day when he gives you a smoke alarm. And that's a pretty good friend there. Now, here's a piece of advice for you. Seize the moment. Remember all those women on the Titanic who waved off the dessert cart. You know, so seize that moment. Have that piece of dessert. All right, here's another one. Know the difference between success and fame. Success is Mother Teresa. Fame is Madonna. Big difference there, isn't there? Definitely. Never go to a class reunion pregnant. They will think that's all you've been up to since you graduated high school. All right, now this is advice that comes from the military and some instruction that comes from military sources. This came out of the U.S. Marine Corps. When the pin is pulled, Mr. Grenade is not your friend. That's a pretty good piece of advice. Now this came from the U.S. Air Force ammo troop. Cluster bombing from B-52s is very, very accurate. The bombs are guaranteed to always hit the ground. Well, they don't really have a choice. I mean, they're falling, so they're going to hit the ground. Now this was from an unknown Marine recruit. And he probably only said this once. Never tell the platoon sergeant you have nothing to do. I think that's a pretty good piece of advice, you know. And then these were instructions that were actually printed on the side of a U.S. rocket launcher. Aim towards the enemy. That's pretty sad that you have to put that on there, but I understand the need to do that. You know, there's a lot of advice out there, isn't there? Not all of it's good advice. Not all of it's somewhat good advice. Some of it's just plain bad advice, isn't it?
But what about advice of how to respond to the things we've been talking about the past few Sundays? We've been talking about trials. Last Sunday we talked about temptations. What about the advice that we have to deal with trials, to deal with temptations? James gives us some help when it comes to dealing with trials and temptations like we talked about the past couple Sundays. Here in these few verses here, he gives us some advice to live by. So with that in mind, if you're physically able, stay with me in honor of reading God's holy word. And let's look there, beginning in James chapter 1, down in verse 19. So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath, for the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. Father, as we dive into your word this morning, open our hearts, open our minds, maybe open our eyes to be receptive to what you're calling us to do. This isn't advice that we treat like everybody's advice. We say, okay, whatever, and we just never do anything with it. But this is truly advice from your word that we can live by, that will help us in the times of trials, that will help us in the times of temptation, that we respond the right way, that we come out on the other side being more Christ-like, that we come out on the other side being more pleasing to you and being victorious over these temptations we face. So, Lord, may we take these pieces of advice to heart and apply them to our lives. And I ask of you, Holy Spirit, that you empower me to preach your word this morning. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. If we're going to make it through the trials of life, if we're going to make it through the temptations that we face in life, we need to follow God's advice. Now, let's be honest. Everybody in the world will give you advice when you're going through trials. I mean, you think about Job and Job's friend. Job's world was falling apart. He lost everything, lost all that he had, lost his kids, everything like that. And his friends, you know, gave some very bad advice. Job had not sinned to bring that on. You know, the story of Job is that God allowed Satan to test Job. But what his friends told him is that you have sinned, you need to get right with God. So even their friends' advice may not be advice to live by. But I'll guarantee you this, the advice that God gives us on any issue of life, especially going through trials, especially facing temptations, is advice you can live by. And this is advice to follow, because when we follow God's advice, we become more Christ-like. We grow in our faith. We are pleasing to God. So James gives us three pieces of advice here that we need to live by so we can make it through these trials of life, so we can properly handle these temptations that we deal with in life. First, number one, we need to respond the right way. That's the first piece of advice, respond the right way. Let's just be honest. Whatever the circumstances in life, you can think of a circumstance stamps right now in life, we don't always respond like we should, do we? I mean, it could be something that happened at work. It could be something that happened between you and your spouse, you and your kids, or something that happened between you and your neighborhood. And sometimes we don't respond the right way. We may get mad. We may get angry. We may get selfish. And we start focusing on ourselves, thinking, this is all about me. You need to meet my needs, meet my wants, that sort of thing. We may want to get even. Someone may hurt us. Someone may steal money from us. Some of us may do something to our family, and we want to get even with them. Sometimes we get overly emotional, don't we? We just kind of lose it. Sometimes we have no emotion at all. It's like we're just emotionally dead. Sometimes we get frustrated, don't we? We get frustrated at the situation and how the situation is being dealt with. And so we face different circumstances of life where we don't always respond the right way. That's also true when it comes to facing trials. We don't always respond to trials the right way. That's also true when it comes to facing temptations. We don't always respond to temptations the right way. And that's why James tells us here in verse 19, look what he says. So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. Now notice that phrase there, be swift to hear. It means to be a careful listener, making sure that we pay attention in order to get the message that is coming across. We may hear what someone is saying, but sometimes we're not truly listening, are we? We're not truly listening. And therefore, we miss the message that is coming across. We may miss the message. Now, I know this doesn't happen in y'all's homes. Let me just preface by this. I know I'm not preaching to y'all this morning. This is somebody else. This may be somebody watching online. So this doesn't happen to y'all. You know, you have a husband sitting there, let's just say last Sunday, watching the Super Bowl. And the wife comes in and she starts saying something right in the middle, you know, as they're getting close to the end of the game when he's getting ready to kick that field goal. And she starts saying something and he hears her, but he's not really listening. Now, I know that doesn't happen in your house. But that's the image that James is giving here, is that we kind of hear, but we're not listening to the message that's coming across. Stop looking at your husbands. Now, come on. It's not that bad. But that's what he's saying here. He says we need to be swift to hear, that we really hear the message that's coming across. James is telling us here, in the midst of our trials, You need to slow down and be swift to hear. Why do we need to be swift to hear in the midst of our trials? Because if we're not truly listening, we're going to miss the message that God has for us. We're going to miss what He wants to do in our life through the midst of these trials. If you go back and remember at the beginning of James chapter 1, it tells us the purpose of trials is to grow our faith, to make us more mature. But if we're not listening to what God is teaching us in the trials, if we're not listening to what His message is, we're going to miss that purpose. We need to listen for the help that God gives us in the midst of trials. You know, we have a wonderful thing called the body of Christ. But oftentimes we think we have to go through trials all by ourselves. Friend, you don't. The body of Christ is meant to share life together, that we are here, that when one of us hurts, all of us hurts. When one of us can rejoice, all of us rejoice. So God offers help in the midst of our trials. But if we're not listening, if we're not being swift to hear, we may not hear that God is saying, hey, that phone call you just got from that brother or sister in Christ, that text you just got, that was me providing help for you. We need to listen to what God's Word says in the midst of trials, because we may need comfort, we may need encouragement, we may need strength to handle those trials. But if we're not listening to what God's Word says, we're going to miss out on it. We need to listen to what the Holy Spirit inside of us is telling us to do, how He's guiding us, how He's given us wisdom to make decisions in the midst of these trials. But if we're not swift to hear, we're just going to be listening to ourselves, not listening to the Holy Spirit. What is it that God is trying to teach us in these trials is what we're trying to hear what the message is. So we have to be swift to hear. If we are too busy focusing on the trials, the storms of life, or we're too busy running our mouths because we think we know it all, or we're doing something else and we're not truly listening, we're going to miss out on what God is doing in our lives and what God wants to do through our lives. We're going to miss the purpose. We're going to miss the message. Now, in the midst of temptation, we need to be swift to hear as well. You know, we need to listen what God is revealing to us for the way of escape. You know, we talked about the way of escape last time. We talked about temptation, how God provides a way of escape. You know, it may be that God provides that by the Holy Spirit reminding us of a scripture we memorized. It may be that it's that phone call from our brother or sister in Christ. It may be that it's that text. It may be whatever. It could be many things. But if we're not swift to hear what God's doing, we're going to miss that way of escape. We need to listen to God's Word as He gives us the power to resist temptation. And we memorize God's Word. We get it in our lives and we apply it in our lives. We need to listen in the midst of temptation to the Holy Spirit, who can encourage us and strengthen us and empower us to overcome the temptations we face. And if we're not listening in the midst of temptations, then what happens? We give in and we sin against God. We break fellowship with God. The relationship's never broken, but our fellowship is broken because there's sin in our life. We can mess up our fellowship with our wives or our husbands because we have sinned against God. We can mess up our relationship, our fellowship with our kids. We can miss out on doing what God has called us to do because we have given in to temptation because we haven't been swift to hear. We can miss out on impacting someone's life with the gospel because we've gotten sidetracked. We've given in to our temptations and we keep on sinning and we're not listening to what God is trying to tell us. We miss out on the opportunities to share the gospel with someone. See, there's repercussions when we don't listen. And then James says this, we're called to be slow to speak as well. You can't listen carefully while you're talking all the time, or even while you're thinking about what to say. You ever been in one of those conversations, and somebody's talking to you, and you're listening, but you're not really listening because you're thinking of how you're going to respond? And then they say something, you're like, huh, what'd you say? You know, that's the image here, is that we have to be slow to speak. In the midst of trials, in the midst of temptations, we need to do more listening than talking. I mean, like the old saying goes, we should listen more because God gave us two ears and one mouth. You ever heard that one? You know? I mean, we need to be, you know, slow to speak. We get ourselves in trouble when we talk too much. Have you noticed that? Sometimes we just let it rip and it's like we can't stop talking. And what happens? All of a sudden, we get ourselves in trouble. You know? Husbands, I know you've never done that. I understand. I'm not talking to y'all this morning. I get that. You know, James is a very practical book, but so is the book of Proverbs. I love the book of Proverbs. I'm reading through the book of Proverbs, the chapter that coincides with the day. You know, I read the 19th today, this morning. Today is the 19th of February. And there's so much practical wisdom and guidance in the book of Proverbs, just like there is in the book of James. And the book of Proverbs has a lot to say about our talking, about what we say. Listen to some of this. Proverbs 13:3 says this, he who guards his mouth preserves his life, but he who opens wide his lips shall have destruction. If someone is not careful in what they say and how much they say, they can bring destruction into their life, can't they? And they can bring destruction into someone else's life. It can affect those around you. We need to guard the words that come out of our mouth so we don't bring destruction into our lives, so we don't bring destruction into the lives of others. And then Proverbs 29, verse 20 says this, "Do you see a man hasty in his words? There is more hope for a fool than for him." This guy didn't take mama's advice. He didn't think before he spoke. He just let it run, and he just let it rip, and it kind of bypassed his brain, came straight out the mouth. You know? They just open their mouths. These people just open their mouths and just talk and don't even think about what they're saying. The Bible says there's more hope for a fool than someone who does this, that doesn't think before they speak. Now, someone may say this, "Well, Dave, you know what? I think before I speak. I think very carefully. I think about how I'm going to chew that person out. I think about how I'm going to give them a piece of my mind. I think about how I'm just going to tell their business to everyone. I think before I speak." That's not what I'm talking about here. You know, we need to be careful the type of thinking we're doing. I'm not talking about that sort of thinking. I'm talking about that we're careful in what we say and how we say it so that we don't tear people down. That our words should build people up. Our words should glorify Christ. Our words should point people to Jesus. But the sad reality is that too many Christians, their words, instead of pointing people to Jesus, they push people away from Jesus. We need to be careful what we say. We need to be slow to speak in the midst of these trials, in the midst of these temptations, because we may fly off the handle and say stuff in the midst of a trial, in the midst of a hardship, and we have non-Christians around that are watching us, and then all of a sudden, why would I ever want to be a Christian? Look at what they're going through, and they're behaving like this, they're talking like this, and we push people away from Jesus. Sometimes the best thing to do, and probably our mama told us this, sometimes the best thing to do is to keep your mouth what? Shut. That's right. We know it. And we're not always follow mama's advice. But listen to Proverbs 17:28. "Even a fool is kind of wise when he holds his peace. When he shuts his lips, he is considered perceptive." Oh, mama gave us some biblical advice there, didn't she? You know, they may think we're a fool, but let's not prove it by opening our mouth. You ever heard that? You know, sometimes they consider that we're wise, we're perceptive, just because we don't say anything. Sometimes the best thing to do is not to say anything at all. You know, we need to be slow to speak in the midst of our trials. We need to be slow to speak in the midst of our temptations so we can then listen to what the Holy Spirit is saying to our heart, to how he's leading us. So we let God's word speak into our life, to speak about the situations we're dealing with, whether it's a trial or whether it's a temptation we're struggling with. So we can find the help that we need to have victory over this temptation, so we can find the strength we need to make it through this trial we're going through. But if we're just running at our mouth all the time and acting like we know it all, we know what's best, we're going to miss out on it. And if we're not careful, we can respond a different way in trials, as James indicates here. We can respond with wrath in the midst of trials. We can respond with wrath even in the midst of temptations. James says we need to be slow to wrath as well, not just slow to speak, but also slow to wrath. Wrath, or your version may say anger, is a very natural response almost an automatic response because, you know, that's just the way our flesh is. And even believers, sometimes we respond this way when we don't spiritually prepare ourselves for life. And so therefore, something comes in life, a trial or a temptation, and we get angry, we get wrathful. Now that word wrath there, it's not the explosive type of outburst you might think it is. This is an inner, deep resentment that just smolders and it just builds there. So often it's unnoticed by others. Not that it can't be seen by others, people that know us very well, but the Lord sees it and we know it's there. Therefore, it's very dangerous because we can harbor that wrath for a long time and we can let it build and we can let it smolder and get bigger and bigger and bigger. And then when a trial comes, we lash out. When a temptation comes, we lash out. We may get angry at the trial that we're going through or the temptation that we're facing. And you know, here's the reality. It can ruin our testimony by the way that we respond. We become angry at God even. We get mad at God because, you know, we blame God for it. God is the one who let me go through this trial. And we blame God for it. We get mad at him, not seeing the purpose that he has in the midst of this trial. God is the one who let me face the temptation. And that anger begins to boil over and affects the relationship we have with our wives or our husbands. It affects the relationship we have with our children. It affects the relationship we have with each other here in the body of Christ. It can damage our fellowship with the Lord greatly. It can damage our fellowship with each other. It can hinder our witness for God. And once again, just like the way we talk sometimes, it can drive people away from Jesus. Proverbs also has some good wisdom to share with us about wrath. Listen to Proverbs 14:29. He who is slow to wrath has great understanding, but he who is impulsive exalts folly. When we are slow to wrath, we have time to think about what is going on in the situation. In the midst of that trial, we're slow to wrath, so we have time to think about how we're going to respond to this trial. In the midst of that temptation, if we're slow to wrath, we have time to think about how we're going to deal with temptation biblically and have victory over the temptation. And then we can respond in a biblical way to either situation. Otherwise, when we're quick to wrath, we respond impulsively. And the Proverbs there tells us it leads to recklessness in our lives. Things just get worse. Proverbs 15:1 says this, a soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Friend, if you want to be slow to wrath, and you want, you know, your words to be glorifying to God, if you want to respond the right way, sometimes the best way to do is give a soft answer, as it says here. You know, give a gentle answer is what it's talking about here. Not just in what you say, but in how you say that. We have to be careful in how we say things as well. You know, if you're married, you probably learned that early on in married life, didn't you? You know, it's not just what you say, but how you say it. You know, it matters. We need to give a soft answer, because what happens when we give a harsh answer? All of a sudden, it's like the flames of the argument just get higher and higher and hotter and hotter. But when you give a soft answer, things tend to calm down a little bit. So how are you responding in the midst of trials that you face? How are you responding in the midst of temptations you face? Are you quick to listen? Are you slow to speak? Are you slow to become angry? This is how we should respond, to make it through the trials in a way that honors God, to make it through the temptations in a way that we can come out victorious, and we can grow because of this. We can grow in our faith. We can grow to become more Christ-like. And we can be pleasing to God. This is the way that God tells us how we should respond. This truly is advice to live by. Now, there's just another piece of advice that James gives us here. Number two, we need to reject what comes natural. Reject what comes natural. Last week, we talked about how, as Christians, when we're saved, we still have our sinful flesh inside of us, don't we? And it's that sinful flesh we saw last week that has sinful desires that tempts us. And we give into those desires, and we give into that temptation, and we sin. And we deal with the consequences of that sin. Well, part of that sinful nature, part of that sinful flesh that we have is the way that sometimes we respond, what we would call naturally, to certain situations of life. We respond out of that sinful flesh. When someone does something that they don't agree with, that we don't agree with, we may quickly become judgmental. We may quickly become harsh towards them. We may respond in a way that is not Christ-like at all. And therefore, we push people away from Christ. Therefore, it hinders our fellowship with the Lord. That's what comes out of our sinful flesh. But instead, we should be responding out of our new spirit that we have inside of us, out of our new nature that's given us. We should be gracious. We should be giving them the benefit of the doubt. You say, well, you don't understand what they've done to me. They really hurt me. They did this to me. They did that to me. They weren't gracious to me. I mentioned this at the men's conference. Let me just mention it here. Stop and think about what we've done to Jesus. All that we've done to Jesus all of our years. I'm 47 years old. I have done a lot to Jesus over those 47 years. And Jesus is always gracious to me. He's always gracious. And we're called to be gracious. Look what James says here in verse 20. For the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. You see, our natural response out of the flesh, and we respond out of sinful nature, is to lash out with wrath, to lash out with anger when we face trials, when we face temptations. Let me just give you some examples. Some examples of how we might respond out of our sinful flesh. Maybe you come into work tomorrow and they lay you off. And we get mad. We get angry. Don't they know who I am? Don't they know my devotion to this company? Don't they know what I've done? And what we don't realize is the company has been bought out and they're laying everybody off. It's not just you. Everybody's getting laid off. And we just respond out of our sinful nature. And what happens is we can hurt our testimony there at our workplace. Or what about this? This is probably a common one if you drive up and down 501 in any length of period, or you're just out on one of these country roads, you're cruising along, you got somewhere to go, all of a sudden somebody pulls out in front of you and just goes slow. Boy, that will bless your heart, won't it? You got someplace to be and you're on a two-lane road, one of these back roads, and somebody pulls out in front of you and they're doing about 15 under the speed limit. I can't believe they pulled out in front of me. They did that on purpose. And we take it personal, don't we? You know, I'm going to get around them as soon as I can get around them. And you don't care if it's a dash line or not. You're going to get around that person. And you know what you're going to do? I'm going to slam on brakes and teach them a lesson. And you know what? I'm going to show them they're number one when I'm passing by them too. And you know what I mean by that. You know, we respond like that. But what we don't realize is maybe that person's not thinking clearly. Maybe they just got laid off from work. Maybe they just had a loved one die. But all we know is they cut us off, and all we know is that we're going to get even with them, and all we know is that we're going to give them the fingers. We go by, and they read our bumper sticker that says, honk if you love Jesus. That's what happens when we respond out of our sinful flesh. Or maybe something like this. I can't believe God would allow this to happen to me. Why would God put me through this trial in my life? And we get mad at God, we get angry at God, and we lash out at God, we don't have anything to do with God. I'm not coming to church anymore, I'm done. What God is trying to do is to strengthen your faith and to grow your faith and make you more Christ-like. Or we say something like this. You know, if God loved me, he wouldn't let me face this type of temptation. It's his fault I'm being tempted. I'll show him. He's going to tempt me this way. I'll just give in then and I'll sin. Remember last week we talked about this? God can't tempt us. It's not in his nature to tempt us. Temptation comes from the world. Temptation comes from Satan. Temptation comes from ourselves. You know, we all face different reactions to things of life. We all face different reactions to the trials and the temptations we go through. It's because of that sinful flesh that wants to rise up inside of us. Listen to what James says in chapter 4 of the book of James in verses 1 and 2. Where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires for pleasure that war in your members? You lust and do not have, you murder and covet and cannot obtain, you fight in war. James is reminding us there in chapter 4 that wrath can come from us. Therefore, we need to reject what is natural. And what I mean by that, what comes from our sinful flesh. What comes from that sinful nature that's still inside of us. Look what again what he says in verse 20 of chapter 1. The wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Our wrath will not make us more Christ-like, no matter what we may think, no matter how we may justify it. It will not grow our faith. It will not accomplish what is right in God's eyes. Therefore, we need to reject what comes naturally from our sinful flesh. This is advice to live by. I mean, let's just be honest. Let's look at our lives. How do we respond when we face trials? How do we respond when we face temptations? Do we listen to our sinful flesh or do we listen to the Spirit? And do we live by that new nature that we have been given at the point of salvation? Do you let your sinful flesh rise up and guide you? Or do you listen to the leading of the Holy Spirit who's inside you? Don't forget that when you were saved, God gave you this new nature. You don't have to live by that sinful nature anymore. He made you a new man. He made you a new woman. Listen to what Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 22 through 24. He says, put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that you may put on the new man which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. The idea is putting off, taking off an old coat, taking off those old sinful ways because we are different now. We've been saved. We know Jesus is our Savior. He's given us a new nature. Therefore, we need to put on these things. Put on the new way of living. We need to stop living according to the flesh and start living according to the Spirit. How can we live that way? That leads to the final piece of advice this morning. Number 3, receive what is life-changing. We need to receive what is life-changing. Look what he says in verse 21. Therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. If we want to respond the proper way to the trials of life we face, so we don't respond out of our sinful flesh, if we want to respond the proper way to the temptations that we deal with day in and day out, so we don't respond out of our sinful flesh, then we need to let God's Word truly impact our lives. That's what we're talking about here. Paul says that we're to lay aside all filthiness. James says we're to lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness. In other words, we need to prepare ourselves to encounter God's Word so God's Word can do a work in our heart so we can have victory over temptation, so we can make it through the trials of life. That word filthiness there, it refers to any sort of moral defilement or moral impurity. And it's closely related to a term that's used for wax in your ear. Maybe you got this morning, you took that Q-tip and you got some wax out of your ear so you could hear me better this morning. But that's the idea here. What does wax do? It impairs our hearing. You let that wax build up in the ear and What'd you say, dear? I can't hear you. And she thinks you're just messing with her because you don't want to listen to what she's got to say, but you got wax build up. That happens in our life when we let that filthiness, that moral filthiness build up. It becomes a barrier in our life to hear what God has to say through His Word to us. And then there's that word wickedness there. It denotes moral evil and corruption in general, but especially in regard to the intent behind it. It pertains to sin that's deliberate. It pertains to sin that is determined. That we're determined, we're deliberate, we're going to do these things. Friend, when we live this way of filthiness and wickedness as Christians, we're not going to hear what God has to say through His Word. So we have to prepare our hearts to encounter God's Word. Filthiness and wickedness describes the lives that we live before we trusted Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior. We don't have to live that way anymore. Paul tells us in Romans, those chains have been broken in our life. And when we trust Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, we're given that new nature. We don't have to live by filthiness and wickedness anymore. We can walk in the Spirit. We can live in the Spirit. Listen to what Paul wrote in Colossians chapter 3, verses 8 through 10. But now you yourselves are to put off these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of Him who created you. There's the image again of putting off the old way of life, putting on the new. Friend, if you want to encounter God's Word in a way that's going to help you be victorious in temptation, it's going to help you survive through the trials of life, you've got to get rid of that filthiness in your life. You've got to put off that old way of living. You've got to put off that wickedness in your life, and you've got to put on the things of God. You've got to put on what corresponds with your new nature. The new man, the new woman, describes the way we're supposed to be, how we're supposed to live according to God's Word. You see, when we still live the old ways of life, the way of filthiness, the way of wickedness, it's like that earwax. We can't hear what God's saying to us. God's Word wants to help us grow. He wants to use His Word to teach us so we can properly and biblically make it through the trials of life, the temptations of life. Peter put it this way in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, lay aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all speaking. As newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the Word, that you may grow thereby. Instead of desiring the things of our old sinful nature, we need to be desiring the things of God. We need to desire the things of God's Word so we can grow in our faith, so we can grow to be more Christ-like, which in turn will help us to better face these trials, which in turn will help us to be better victorious over temptations of life. We need to lay aside all this filthiness and wickedness in our lives so we can do what James says there in verse 21, that we can receive with meekness the implanted Word which is able to save your souls. That word implanted there has a literal meaning of planting a seed in the ground. And here's what it means. It's metaphorically of God's Word being implanted and taking root in our heart at the time of salvation. And as we study God's Word, as we get God's Word in our lives, as we listen to God's Word, and with the help of the Holy Spirit to help us interpret the Word, God uses His Word, God uses the Holy Spirit to empower us so we can live the way He's called us to live. So we can endure these trials, so we can see the purpose behind these trials, so we can become more Christ-like, so we can grow in our faith, so we can be victorious over these temptations. Because we are a child of God. And that's what comes with being a child of God. You see, it is the Word of God that will help us to continue living the way we're called to live according to His Word. It helps us and shows us and grows us and gives us wisdom and guides us how to handle the trials of life. How to handle those difficulties when someone you love stabs you in the back, when your boss lays you off for no reason whatsoever, whatever may happen, when you're faced with an unbearable temptation that you think you can't handle, you turn back to God's Word, you find the strength, you find that way of escape. But if we don't lay aside this filthiness and wickedness in our life, remember, it's like earwax, it's a barrier to letting God's Word impact our lives. You're going to be stuck with that image for the next 3 weeks, aren't you, of earwax? Well, good. I'm glad it's going to stick with you. Because we need to make sure we get that out of our lives so we can let God's Word impact us. We need God's Word to change us, to be more Christ-like, so we can be victorious over temptation, so we can respond in a way that is honoring, glorifying, and edifying to others and ourselves in the midst of trials. We also need to be in the Word of God so we know what God wants for us, what His desire is for us, what His will is for us, so we can live a way that is pleasing to Him, that brings Him honor and glory. We're to get into God's Word. We're to apply it to our lives to let it change us, even in the areas of life where it's painful. Because let's be honest, none of us are perfect in living up to God's Word. If you find somebody that says, I live perfectly in God's Word, they're lying to you. None of us live perfectly. We all have room for improvement. And sometimes that improvement is painful, isn't it? Because that means we have to change the way we're living. We have to change the way we're thinking. But one day when we stand before Jesus at the judgment seat of Christ, and He looks at our lives and He sees the change that took place because we were devoted to the Word and we lived by the Word, He will be pleased. He will be pleased. Did you know that living by the Word is a sign that you're a true believer? Listen to what John chapter 8, verse 31 says. Then Jesus said to the Jews who believed Him, "If you abide in My Word, you are My disciples indeed." Living by the Word is a sign you're a true believer. By abiding in the Word of God, we're giving evidence that we truly belong to God, that we are truly His disciples, because we are letting His Word change our lives, that we are becoming more Christ-like. See, God's Word is life-changing. It's the Word of God that led us to the point of salvation, is it? Paul tells us in Romans, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. It's life-changing. But it doesn't stop at the point of salvation. God's Word grows us. God's Word convicts us. God's Word helps us through the trials of life. It shows us what we need to change so we can become more Christ-like. God's Word gives us what we need to have victory over temptation. That's why it's so vitally important that we receive God's Word into our life, but apply it. Don't just receive it and do nothing with it. That's useless. We've got to apply it to our lives. We've got to live by it. So let me just ask you this morning. Are you laying aside the filthiness in your life? Are you laying aside the wickedness in your life so you can better receive God's Word? Because friend, if you've got filthiness, if you've got wickedness in your life, these sinful things we've talked about, you're not going to receive God's Word like you should. That's why people will go into a Sunday school class. That's why people will go into a worship service and they'll walk out and say, "I don't know what he was talking about. I don't know what the teacher was saying. I don't know what the preacher was saying. That had nothing to do with me." You didn't prepare yourself to receive it. Just like I prepare myself to preach God's Word, friend, you got to prepare yourself to hear God's Word. Because if you don't, you're going to walk out here the same way you came in. No different. Maybe that's where you need to start, is you got to start preparing yourself to encounter God's Word. Even now, before you go hear your Sunday school teacher, maybe you just need to confess and repent of that filthiness and that wickedness in your life so you can better receive God's Word in your life. And friend, when God's Word comes to your life, like I said, it will change you and it will help you and strengthen you in the midst of trials and temptations. Great advice to live by, because it's not my advice, it's not mama's advice, it's God's advice. What advice are you living by in your everyday life? Is it the advice of the world? Man, if you're following the advice of the world, you're in trouble. If you're advice of the government, oh, Lord help you there too. Is it your advice? Is it somebody else's advice or is it God's advice? Friend, the advice that we need to live by is God's advice that we find in His Word. If you want to make it through the trials of life, if you want to have victories over temptation of life, excuse me, come out better on the other side, we need to live by God's advice. So why not start today? Maybe you need to respond the right way to what you're facing. Maybe you need to reject what comes natural. Maybe you need to receive what is life-changing like we've talked about. It's never too late to start. It's never too late to keep going. Maybe you're doing all these things, praise God, and you just want to ask God to help you, to continue, to strengthen you so you can keep on doing these things. But maybe where you need to start today is you need to give your life to Jesus Christ. That's the best advice God has ever given, is that we are sinners who need a Savior. He has pointed out our wretchedness. He has pointed out our need for a Savior because our sins, we're going to die one day and spend eternity in hell. But God loved us so much that He sent His Son, Jesus, to die in our place. And on Calvary's cross, He paid for our sins and He died. He was buried, but He rose again the third day. You say, what's the big deal about that? Because it proves who He is. and proves that he can do what he came to do. And that is to give you everlasting life. That is to give you forgiveness of sins and to save you from that penalty if you'll just cry out to him and ask him to do so. And he will do it. Maybe that's where you need to start today. So let's look at our life this morning. What advice are we living by? Father, I give you praise. As we start out the service thanking how worthy you are of our praise, I give you praise for the advice you give us. And this is just a small tidbit found in your word. But your word is full of advice to live by. So Lord, I pray that we will honestly look at our lives this morning to see, are we living by your word? Are we living by the word of mankind, of this world, of this government, ourselves, whatever it is? And if it's not you, if it's not your advice, that we're not living right. So help us get there this morning. Whatever that may mean, confessing sin, repenting of sin, getting right with you, asking him for strength, asking him for hope, asking him for comfort, encouragement, maybe giving our lives to you. For those that don't know Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, whether they're here or whether they're watching online. But Lord, in this time of decision, may we do what your Holy Spirit now is calling us to do. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and let's sing. And as we sing, you respond as the Holy Spirit is leading you this morning.
I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. Take that cross and follow. Follow me, where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. I'll go with him,
with you. That's kind of hard to do since he's in Moldova, so I'm so used to that, but just want to share these things with you. If you're a guest, well, once again, we're so glad you're here. We do want to connect with you, so I want to encourage you to fill out those connect cards. They're in the foyer. They're over in our welcome center. I want to encourage you to take it over to our desk over there. We've got a free gift for you, but we're so glad you're here. And then men, want to invite you to our Men of Iron Bible study tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. We meet over in Co-Ed 2 class. You can come in that side door over there. This has been a great time. This is the best study we've ever done in all the years we've been doing it. And God is blessing and working in a mighty way in the lives of our men. So if you never come, don't think, well, it's too late. You can come tomorrow night. It's at 7 o'clock. You'll see all the trucks and cars parked out there. Just come in that side door. And we had a great time last time. Looking forward to that. That being said, this study is in different volumes. And next month in March, we're starting volume 2. And so if you want a study book to go with Volume 2, you can sign up out in the Welcome Center. There's a sign-up sheet out there. Some of the guys signed up last month for a study guide. And so we want to get you the study guides. You don't have to have a study guide to do it, but if you want to have one just to benefit your study a little bit further, we want to encourage you to sign up for that. And then this Saturday is our church-wide baked potato and salad dinner, a great time of coming together. Of course, we're going to eat, but we're just going to have a good time of just being together as family and just having a great fellowship together. The potatoes are going to be provided, the salad's going to be provided, but we need your help with providing the toppings and the dressing, desserts and drinks. And we also need your help by knowing if you're coming or not so they can make sure we have enough. So out in the foyer, many of you have already done that, but if you haven't, we just need you to sign up, just your name and how many are coming. That way our fellowship team can be prepared. But I hope you'll come. That's this Saturday at 5 o'clock. Is that right, Janice? I didn't write the time down. 5 o'clock. So I want to encourage you to be here this Saturday. It's going to be a great time of just being together with the family of God. And then, as I mentioned, next Sunday is Baptist Women's Day, and so our ladies are leading us in worship. Sherry Clayton, like I said, is going to be here from Cry Freedom Missions. And if you don't know anything about Cry Freedom Missions, please be here. If you do, please be here anyways, because this is a great ministry that is really meeting a part of society that we don't like to talk about. Human trafficking is major in America. And so we need to do everything we can to rescue these people, to get them out of that lifestyle, for one, but to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. And some of the stories that I've been privileged to hear, some of the videos I've seen, God is working in a mighty way through this great ministry. And so we encourage you to be here. Ladies, we need your help with singing in our ladies' choir. And so we had practice, y'all had practice this past Wednesday. You're going to practice. I keep saying we. I'm not a lady. Y'all are going to practice this Wednesday after Bible study. It's going to be brief. You're just singing one song. And if you weren't here Wednesday and got the sheet music and a CD and you want to pick that up, be prepared for this Wednesday. There's a copy of the sheet music and some CDs out there you can pick up and you can listen to be prepared for this Wednesday. So I do want to encourage you to stay after Bible study this Wednesday night for ladies to practice the one song for Sunday. And so be praying, as I already mentioned, for Baptist Women's Day. And then if you remember back in 2021, the Lord led us to keep the two worship service schedule that we started during COVID. You know, we started out with COVID to spread out, everything like that. But the deacons and the pastors, we prayed about this for a long time, and God led us to keep that schedule. And God is blessed with having us two services. I saw one of our members yesterday at work, and they said, I can't be there tomorrow, you know, because I have to work. But the days I have to work later, I can go to the early service and that sort of thing. So God is blessing through these two services. But we realize sometimes we miss seeing each other. So every so often, we're going to have just a day where we just have one worship service together. We're calling that, let me make sure I get it right, All Together Sundays. We're going to be all together for worship. And so our first one's coming up March 12th. Now, we're kind of helping you out with that because that's the day of the time change, so you lose an hour of sleep. So that day, we're not going to have an 8:45 service. We're going to have Sunday school at 10 and then one joint worship service at 11. So we just want to come together, all together as the body of Christ, and worship and fellowship and have a good time together. So throughout the year, we're going to have special Sundays like that, just so we can join together. And that's also why it's so important for to be a part of like this fellowship this coming Saturday night, this baked potato salad dinner, that we can come together as a family of God. But God is blessing through the two worship services, but we want to continue just to stay connected as well. So March 12th will be our first all-together Sunday. So just want to make you aware of that. And then as Pastor Cameron has been sharing with you, Tables of Love is coming up. And we've explained it some, but in case you don't know what it is, this is a great time to get together on Saturday the 25th. It starts at 6 p.m. Doors open at 6 p.m. And so our youth are going to do a great time putting on a show. I've had privilege of being part of the first rehearsal and doing some videotaping and stuff like that. It's going to be unlike anything we've ever done. A little bit different. We haven't done something like this before. But also, you're going to have a good meal first. And so this is a great time of fellowship as well, just entertainment. And so I want to encourage you to be a part of that. If you want to go, we just need you to sign up because you can sign up in two different ways. You can sign up to host a table. That means you invite people to come sit at your table, whether they're people in the church or people outside the church. This is a great opportunity to invite people into to the church. Or if you don't want to host a table, you can sign up individually, and we can just plug you into one of those tables that has some vacancies. And so, but we do need you to sign up because we have limited number of space because it pretty much fills up every year. This is also a great opportunity as a fundraiser for our mission trips. So if the Lord lays your heart to give towards the mission trips, there's going to be a bucket on the table that night. You can give in that bucket. This is not the main emphasis, but it's just an opportunity for us to give towards the upcoming mission trips. You know, we're going to send a team in Moldova again this year, Lord willing, West Virginia. Our youth go to Fuge in South Carolina. And so just some mission trips we have going on. So be praying about it. The Lord is leading your heart on your heart to give towards that opportunity. But that's March 25th, 6 o'clock in the evening. If you haven't signed up, you can sign up over in the Welcome Center. And then one more thing. Excuse me, I want to make aware of in the Welcome Center are those blessing bags, you know, that are there for the homeless. This is a great opportunity just to grab a couple bags, put them in your car. When you're out and about, you see someone who's homeless, and just say, hey, here's a blessing bag from our church. We hope you're blessed. This is a great way for us to meet some physical needs, but also inside that is the gospel track. So we want to encourage you to give those out, pick some up until they're all gone. I think the last I looked, the crate's about half empty. So I do want to encourage you to pick those up and keep them in your car so you can give them out. So it's been great to worship you this morning. I want to encourage you to go to Sunday school and just have a great time continuing to study God's Word. Let me pray for us. Father, we thank you for how much you love us. We thank you for your care for us. We just praise you for who you are. And Lord, we thank you that you have given us your word to live by, to change our lives. May we apply it, may we live it out this week as we go from this place seeking to impact this community for you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.